Tantor Audio, a division of Recorded Books, presents Selling Hate, Marketing the Ku Klux Klan, by Dale W. Laackman, narrated by Jonathan Yen. Introduction. This is not a Klan book. There have been many books written about the history and the activities of the Ku Klux Klan. Its violent, clandestine past has been well chronicled. This is a book about selling, about marketing, about public relations, and about journalism. The product just happens to be the Klan. This is a story of two brilliant marketing executives who, in the early days of the 20th century, used their collective genius to spread hate across the United States. The year 1920 saw a combustible mix of socioeconomic conditions, events, and personalities that may never occur again. Edward Young Clark Jr. and Elizabeth Bessie Tyler understood their opportunity and seized it. Their reward was unbelievable treasure. Their place in history lies solidly in the halls of infamy. Their legacy is not a proud one. They could have sold any product. Instead, they chose profit over principle. Their methods and strategies were groundbreaking. The plan was all-encompassing. Their execution was seamless and decisive. This is a cautionary tale. Communications professionals have an obligation to conduct their business responsibly. Their power to persuade is considerable. The public needs to be wary of both message and motive. I am reminded of a powerful image I first saw as a young advertising major in college. Assigned reading for my Introduction to Advertising course was The Hidden Persuaders by Vance Packard. The cover illustration on my paperback edition showed a barbed fishhook buried in a gleaming, fresh red apple. The message was clear. Prologue. Thursday, November 25th, 1915, Thanksgiving Day in Atlanta, Georgia. As days go, it had been fairly typical for late autumn in the heart of the U.S. South. The U.S. Weather Bureau recorded a high temperature of 63, and the low would reach 43 degrees. There was no precipitation reported. The bold heading on the front page of the November 25th Atlanta Constitution read, "Husband slays wife and then shoots self after attending play at theater." Another article announced, "Baghdad almost in grip of British forces." The ancient Babylonian capital was a part of the Central Powers Ottoman Empire. At World War I's end, Britain and Gertrude Bell would create the new nation of Iraq. World War I was in its second year. Earlier in the year, the British ship Lusitania had been sunk by a German U-boat, killing 128 Americans. Woodrow Wilson strove to remain neutral. The United States would not send troops to France for nearly two more years. There was the little matter of Pancho Villa. United States-Mexican relations were strained and tension was high. The Mexican Revolutionary General bristled at the United States aiding the effort to defeat him. The Constitution article on Thanksgiving Day, filed from Nogales, Arizona, told of U.S. troops massing against Villa's men on the Mexican border. In 3 months, on March 9, 1916, Villa would stage one of the most daring invasions of U.S. soil. At 4:20 that morning, he raided and burned the city of Columbus, New Mexico, killing 18 U.S. citizens. General John J. Pershing and 6,000 troops would be dispatched to find and capture Villa. Pershing would never defeat the elusive general. November 25th, 1915, was Andrew Carnegie's 80th birthday. By the time of his death at 84, the steel magnate would give away over $350 million, much of it to build libraries across the country. The sports page previewed Georgia Tech's year-ending football game at Grant Field against arch-rival Alabama Polytechnic Institute. In 1960, Alabama Poly's name would be officially changed to Auburn University. The Civil War had ended just 50 years earlier, and Reconstruction had kept hated federal troops in the South until only 38 years prior to 1915. Confederate veterans still walked the streets, now in their 70s and 80s. Memories of William T. Sherman's burning of Atlanta and march through Georgia were still fresh in the minds of many Georgians. Yet Atlantans still celebrated the national Thanksgiving holiday proclaimed in 1863 by the Republican Union Commander-in-Chief Abraham Lincoln. A notice in the Constitution announced Thanksgiving dinner at the Wyckoff Hotel from 12 to 6:30 p.m. Roast young Georgia turkey, chestnut dressing, cranberry sauce, candied sweet potatoes, fancy appetizers, and desserts. Good food, good service, good music. All for the princely sum of $1. Advertisements in the November 25th edition give a snapshot of life in 1915 Atlanta. Dr. E.G. Griffith's Gate City Dental on Alabama Street featured crown and bridge work for $4, painless extractions for 50 cents, teeth filled for $1, and a complete set of teeth for $5. Davison Paxson Stokes announced a sale of Paradise Plumage, feather trimming for women's hats, a bunch of 10 for $1.95, regularly $3.50. A.O. and Roy Donetto offered a $75 complete funeral with 25 separate items. At the Georgian Movie Theater, you could see the graceful actor Hobart Henley in The Phantom Fortune, a Broadway Universal feature. At the Grand, Dustin Farnham starred in The Gentleman from Indiana. But the events of the day were of little concern to William Joseph Simmons. For months, he had planned an excursion and ceremony that would not be reported in the November 25th Atlanta Constitution. Yet the consequences of this event would resonate in print and history for many years to come. On October 16th, Simmons and 33 other men had applied for a charter from the state of Georgia and Fulton County, Georgia. The charter was for a fraternal, patriotic, secret, not-for-profit organization. In 1915, dozens of similar private clubs operated in Georgia. Fully 4 years before the enactment of Prohibition, Georgia was a dry state, though the Georgia legislature had provided that members of such clubs could keep liquor in their lockers and drink it on the premises. These organizations had come to be known as bottle clubs. As was the custom with fraternal orders, most had elaborate initiations, secret handshakes, intricate hierarchies, and lavish uniforms. Simmons's organization was no different. He had been a member of at least a dozen fraternal societies. What was different was the name affixed to the charter, the Knights of the Ku Klux Klan. On that Thanksgiving evening, Simmons had rented a travel bus, and he and 15 others headed for Stone Mountain at twilight. Stone Mountain today is one of the most popular tourist destinations in Georgia, described as the world's largest exposed piece of granite. Skeptics say larger examples exist and that Stone Mountain is a quartz monzonite dome, therefore not technically granite. Only 16 miles east of Atlanta, it affords views from up to 30 miles on a clear day. The mountain reaches a height of 825 feet above the ground surface and is nearly 5 miles in circumference at the base. Its post-Civil War history boasts a quarry that supplied building materials for the gold depository at Fort Knox, the foundation of the Lincoln Memorial, the Imperial Hotel in Tokyo, and the Panama Canal. Visitors today can golf, camp, and hike at the Stone Mountain Theme Park. They can also take a cable car ride to the summit, view laser and fireworks shows, and boat on Stone Mountain Lake. That it has the world's largest bas-relief carving embedded in its north face, the brainchild of the United Daughters of the Confederacy in 1912, is the mountain's claim to fame. Funds were raised, and a young sculptor was commissioned to design a memorial to Confederate war heroes. Gutzon Borglum envisioned a massive carving featuring General Robert E. Lee. By 1924, creative differences forced Borglum off the project. He went on to another large sculpture, Mount Rushmore, in the Badlands of South Dakota. The Stone Mountain Project continued under Augustus Laackman, and now featured Lee, Confederate President Jefferson Davis, and General Thomas Stonewall Jackson. The Confederate Memorial was ultimately completed in 1970 and measures 90 by 190 feet. The surface covers an area of 3 acres, the size of about 3 football fields. The dedication ceremony in 1970 was attended by a standing U.S. Vice President, Spiro Agnew. An odd decision for a monument to leaders of a rebellion against the federal government. The mountain had become a symbol of slavery and segregation, so much so that it was mentioned in Martin Luther King Jr.'s I Have a Dream speech on August 28, 1963, when he said, "Let freedom ring from Stone Mountain of Georgia." Certainly, Dr. King had in mind Joseph Simmons and his 15 adherents. On that chilly November evening in 1915, there were no miniature golf courses or laser shows. Simmons could not take a cable car ride to the top or gaze on the Confederate heroes. All that lay ahead of him was a cold rock dome with a steep trail to the summit. William Simmons's choice of Stone Mountain was certainly dramatic and possibly symbolic. Lashed atop his rental bus was a tall pine cross that the group solemnly carried to the crest of this barren slab of rock. Simmons's followers dutifully covered the cross with excelsior and soaked it with kerosene. They gathered 16 boulders, presumably one for each of those present, and formed a crude altar on which rested a U.S. flag and an unsheathed sword. Bathed in the blaze of the fiery cross, the 16 dedicated themselves to American principles, the tenets of Protestant Christianity, and the eternal maintenance of white supremacy. Simmons described his new order as the world's greatest secret, social, patriotic, fraternal, beneficiary order, a high-class order for men of intelligence and character. Simmons read a passage from the Bible. Romans 12 drips with the necessary platitudes associated with a fraternal and beneficial organization. It is not known if Simmons read the entire chapter that night, but these verses summarize the intended tone. Recompense to no man evil for evil. Provide things honest in the sight of all men. If it is possible, as much as lieth in you, live peaceably with all men. Be not overcome of evil, but overcome evil with good. With that, the invisible empire was born. Few Atlantans took notice of the orange glow in the distance. Within 4 years, Simmons's clan would be near extinction, with only a few thousand loosely organized members. Yet just 5 years later, in 1924, thousands of Klansmen would boldly march down Pennsylvania Avenue in Washington, D.C. Active Klan chapters would operate in all 48 states. The Klan would be powerful enough to influence state and national elections, and the ranks would swell to 4 to 6 million, nearly one in every 3 eligible men in the United States. This uniquely American drama was played out by a fascinating cast of characters. A charismatic true believer, an amoral flim-flam man, a tough-as-nails single mother, an idealistic whistleblower, and a poetic crusader. It is a tale of violence and terror, of spectacle and sex, of hatred and hypocrisy. And behind the scenes, it is also a story of misguided genius and unbridled greed. Chapter 1. True Believer. Man is made by his belief. As he believes, so he is. Johann Wolfgang von Goethe. Belief creates the actual fact. William James. The thing always happens that you really believe in, and the belief in a thing makes it happen. Frank Lloyd Wright. William Joseph Simmons was a good Calvinist. Calvinists believe in original sin, sometimes called total depravity. All men are born sinful. There's nothing you can do about it. They also believe in unconditional election, a condition also known as predestination. Some men are predestined into everlasting life. They are called the elect. Romans 8 tells Protestants that God already knows the outcome of the choices men make, and God causes everything to work together for the good of those who love Him and are called according to His purpose. William Simmons knew God had a very important plan for his life. He was born on May 6, 1880, in Harpersville, Shelby County, Alabama, to a country doctor named Calvin Henry Simmons and his wife Lavonia David Simmons. Little is known about Simmons's early life, including his formal education. By his own assertion, he intended to follow in his father's footsteps and enter the medical profession. Simmons claimed to have completed some pre-medical training at Johns Hopkins University in Baltimore, but researchers have not been able to find his name in the records there. Since medicine was not in the cards, Simmons next considered a career in the Army. Throughout U.S. history, a tried-and-true path to success came through the military. Heroes have long been revered in American society. As Simmons approached his 18th birthday, the United States was a nation at peace. That was about to change. In the late 1890s, the United States was itching to enter the colonial arena. European powers had long held lands in South America, Africa, and the Far East. U.S. industrialists longed to operate in a mercantilist system that would provide raw materials and markets. It all began innocently enough. The United States began to focus on human rights abuses by the Spanish government in nearby Cuba. President William McKinley hoped for a diplomatic solution, but public favor for war was fanned by a journalistic corps intent on military action and newspaper sales. How long are the Spaniards to drench Cuba with the blood and tears of her people? How long shall old men and women and children be murdered by the score, the innocent victim of Spanish rage against the patriot armies they cannot conquer? How long shall the United States sit idle and indifferent? On February 15, 1898, the U.S. Navy battleship Maine blew up in the harbor of Havana, resulting in the death of 266 American sailors. To this day, it is not certain if the damage was done by Spanish forces or by some accident. Americans were positive of the former. The hesitant President McKinley received a declaration of war on April 23, 1898. Secretary of State John Hay would call the following 10-week conflict a splendid little war. The Navy was prepared for war. The Army was not. With only 28,000 active troops, whose last significant action had come against the Plains Indians, a call went out for 50,000 additional men. A nation hungry for adventure responded with more than 200,000, both volunteers and mobilized state National Guard units. William Joseph Simmons was one who answered the call. The 1st Alabama Volunteer Infantry was organized in Mobile in May 1898. Freshly turned 18, Simmons was there. Patrick McSherry's A Brief History of the 1st Alabama Volunteer Infantry provides an interesting saga. The unit was composed of 48 officers and 941 enlisted men under the command of Colonel E.L. Higdon. Simmons, William J., is found on the roster as a private in Company B, the Wheeler Rifles out of Florence, Alabama. The Alabama volunteers trained quickly and intensely. Eventually, they were stationed in Miami, Florida. There was glory to be found in battle. No one knew that as well as the extremely ambitious Theodore Roosevelt. An architect of the Navy's preparedness as Undersecretary of the Navy, Roosevelt resigned and assembled a volunteer unit known as the Rough Riders. By the middle of June, Roosevelt was in Tampa, ready to embark for Cuba. On July 1st, he led the assault on San Juan Hill that would eventually propel him to the presidency. The 1st Alabama was not so fortunate. They reached their embarkation point, Camp Cuba Libre in Jacksonville, on August 13, 1898, the day the Spanish and the United States agreed to an armistice. Since there was no longer a need for their services, the regiment requested to be relieved from service. The soldiers returned to Birmingham, Alabama, and were given pay and a 30-day furlough. According to McSherry, money and time off proved a recipe for disaster. There were several bloody affairs, including drunken fights and bayonet wounds, with one private shooting another to death. The men of the 1st Alabama were officially mustered out on October 31, 1898, in Birmingham. During its existence, the 1st Alabama recorded the deaths of one officer and 15 enlisted men, all from disease. A total of 32 soldiers were listed as deserters. McSherry concludes that the regiment proved more dangerous to themselves and to other U.S. citizens than to the military forces of Spain. For young William Simmons, the experience apparently dulled any expectations of a military career. As it turns out, a talent William Simmons did possess was with the spoken word. He was a spellbinding speaker. Soon he gravitated to the Protestant ministry, where sermon giving is central to worship. For approximately 10 years, Simmons was in the employ of the Methodist Episcopal Church, South. The denomination was an offshoot of the Methodist Episcopal Church. English theologian John Wesley founded Methodism in the 18th century. He was appalled by slavery, and when the Methodist Episcopal Church was founded in 1784, it officially opposed the institution. But there were congregations in the U.S. South controlled by wealthy plantation owners. In Georgia, a controversy arose in the early 1840s concerning a Methodist bishop, the Reverend James Osgood Andrew. Reverend Andrew owned 2 slaves. The church conference voted to remove Andrew from his office unless he freed his slaves. The dispute led Methodists in the South to break off and form the Methodist Episcopal Church, South, in 1844. At the conclusion of the Civil War, freed blacks left the church to begin their own Methodist denomination, leaving the Methodist Episcopal Church, South, exclusively white. William Simmons worked as a circuit minister. Owing to the rural nature of the South, preachers often had to travel from small church to small church. These communities could not financially support a full-time pastor. Methodist Episcopal Church South records show that 5,368 men were employed as traveling preachers in 1892. Simmons spent his time traveling the circuit to tent revivals and camp meetings. A hellfire and brimstone orator, he gained a reputation as a powerful evangelist. But in 1912, William Joseph Simmons was relieved of duty by the Alabama Methodist Conference for overspending allowances and running his churches into debt. It was during his decade in the ministry that Simmons learned he was predestined by God to perform a great mission. He received an epiphany, a spiritual event arising as a sudden flash of recognition. Later, he would describe that summer evening. Sitting at his window, he had suddenly seen a row of white-robed figures on horseback riding across the sky. Behind them was a rough outline of a map of the United States. He fell to his knees in prayer. Documenting it afterward, he wrote, "Ere long, I clearly conceived the embryonic medium of its supply. I then and there solemnly dedicated my life and consecrated my all to the task of maturing that medium." William Simmons was no stranger to the Ku Klux Klan. Dr. Calvin Henry Simmons had been a member of the original Klan. At his father's knee, he heard many tales of the Klan's activities. His family had African American help, and they too told the young boy of terror-filled days following the Civil War. The history of the first Klan is, in essence, a history of post-Civil War reconstruction. In December 1865, six young men in Pulaski, Tennessee, decided to form a social club. The war had ended in April that year. The six had been officers in the Confederate Army and were looking for something to do to cure their newfound boredom. A number of the six had been college men, familiar with the Southern collegiate fraternity Ku Klux Adelphon. The name translates as Circle of Brothers. They simply added Klan after the word Ku Klux to name the club, later changing the C to K for alliterative convenience. Initially, their sport was to dress up in robes and play the part of ghosts of Confederate dead. The targets of their pranks were superstitious former slaves. The club gained new members, but remained primarily relevant in central Tennessee. Washington, D.C., dictated the next move. Abraham Lincoln had formulated a benevolent process for readmitting the rebellious Southern states back into the Union. Lincoln's untimely death at Ford's Theater had passed the task to his vice president, Andrew Johnson. Under the plan, 10% of each state's 1860 electorate was required to abolish slavery, repeal secession ordinances, and settle any Confederate war debts. Blanket amnesty was given to any ex-Confederate who swore an oath of loyalty to the United States. By November 1865, all states, with the exception of Texas, had come to terms. Newly elected congressmen were ready to return to Capitol Hill. But these Southern states began enacting black codes, which virtually returned black citizens to a status near slavery. This open defiance of civil rights infuriated the radical Republicans, led by Thaddeus Stevens and Charles Sumner, whose sole ambition was to punish the once rebellious states. In a quick series of legislative moves, Congress passed the United States' first Civil Rights Bill and the 14th Amendment to the Constitution, guaranteeing freedmen full citizenship. Finally, in March 1867, Congress passed the first of several Reconstruction Acts. The new southern state governments were dissolved, and the former Confederacy was partitioned into military districts ruled by Union generals. New elections were held, and African Americans were empowered to vote for the first time in Southern history. For Southern whites, the world had turned upside down. It was time for the Klan to act. In April 1867, a meeting was held in Nashville's Maxwell House Hotel to organize and bind isolated groups together. The social situation in the South had changed significantly, and the Klan's goal was to restore the antebellum society of white supremacy. The Klan claimed to be lovers of law and order, peace and justice. They would be just the opposite. The conference elected as their first Grand Wizard Confederate hero Nathan Bedford Forrest, who represented a solid choice for leading a terrorist organization bent on the suppression of African Americans. He was a self-made millionaire who had gained his fortune as a planter, real estate investor, and slave trader. Enlisting as a private at the onset of hostilities, Forrest quickly rose to the rank of lieutenant general, commanding an elite cavalry unit. His most infamous act during the war was the massacre of more than 250 black prisoners of war at Fort Pillow, Tennessee. With that, a reign of terror ensued. In his The Ku Klux Klan, History, Organization, Language, Influence, and Activities of America's Most Notorious Secret Society, Michael Newton describes some of the violence. Murders were common, and floggings more so. One victim was left crippled after he received 900 lashes on a midnight raid. In Alabama, Congress documented 109 murders committed by Grand Dragon John Morgan's Knights, and that number was no doubt conservative. Klansmen burned Greene County's courthouse, followed shortly by three schools for blacks. In Utah, Klan rioters killed four blacks and wounded 50 in October 1870. Georgia was worse under Grand Dragon, later Governor and U.S. Senator, John Gordon. In a three-month period from August to October 1868, Klansmen killed 31 persons, shot 43 more, stabbed 5, and whipped at least 55. Including 8 floggings of 300 to 500 lashes apiece. Much of the Klan violence was politically inspired. Both Northern carpetbaggers and freed blacks tended to vote Republican. Southern whites were overwhelmingly Democrats. Republicans, black and white, were constantly at risk. Klan threats made a significant difference in election outcomes. During the spring primary in 1868 in Oglethorpe County, Georgia, Republicans had received more than 1,100 votes. In the November election, the number had slipped to 116. In Columbia County, the numbers fell from 1,122 to a single vote. Again, it was time for the federal government to intervene. The 15th Amendment was passed, giving the vote to all former slaves. In 1870 and 1871, Congress passed the Force Acts. These laws made it a federal offense to influence voters, to prevent citizens from voting, and to deprive one of civil rights, including life. Finally, in April 1871, a bill called the Ku Klux Act defined Klan violence as rebellion against the United States, allowing the president to declare martial law. President Ulysses S. Grant sent in the 7th Cavalry to arrest and prosecute Klan terrorists. George Armstrong Custer was called in from the Indian Territories and stationed in Elizabethtown, Kentucky. Klan activity in Elizabethtown was minimal, so Custer spent most of his time breeding horses and collecting hunting dogs. The Army intervention was effective, and organized Klan activity ceased to exist in the South. Imperial Wizard Forest decreed a dissolution of the order. Organized violence was no longer necessary, but the residual effort of terror remained. Most African Americans again understood their place in Southern society. The Klan would lie dormant for 43 years. The disputed presidential election of 1876 sealed the fate for African Americans in the South for a long time to come. The Compromise of 1877 secured 20 vital and contested electoral votes for Republican Rutherford B. Hayes. The price was the removal of federal troops in the South. In 1877, the U.S. Army marched out of the former Confederacy, and Reconstruction was over. It took little time for whites to act. Black codes returned as Jim Crow laws, and whites regained control of state legislatures. Whites separated themselves from blacks in virtually every aspect of daily life. The antebellum socioeconomic system had been restored. Slavery was no longer legal, but it was replicated through legislative and economic control. In 1896, the Supreme Court decision Plessy v. Ferguson formally validated segregation as long as it was separate but equal. Of course, it was never equal. If God had chosen William Joseph Simmons to revive the Ku Klux Klan, he had selected a man ill-prepared for the task. Simmons was a talented speaker, but, as his Methodist experience had indicated, not necessarily a gifted organizer and businessman. He needed training, and found it not in the formal arena of academia, but in the hard-knocks, grassroots world of early 20th century fraternal organizations. The period following the Civil War could be called the Golden Age of Fraternalism. 800 different fraternal organizations operated in the United States, and 30 million to 60 million people in the United States, according to the 1920 census, held membership in some fraternal group. Most of these organizations had their beginnings in the late 1800s and the early 1900s. The following is a representative sampling of major fraternal organizations in the 19th century United States. The American Protective Association, 1887. 2 million members in 1900. Opposed Roman Catholicism. Used a patriotism theme. Fraternal Order of Eagles, 1891. Local units called Aries. Membership included many presidents and celebrities. Benevolent and Protective Order of Elks, 1867. Men only. Prominent members included Franklin D. Roosevelt, Harry S. Truman, John F. Kennedy. Ancient Order of Foresters, 1832. Ritual based on Robin Hood and his merry men. Freemasons, 1720. Model for most fraternal groups. Influential in the formation of early U.S. government. Knights of Columbus, 1882. Catholic males, 18 and older. Answered to Freemasonry. Maltese cross as symbol. Knights of Pythias, 1864. Based on the story of Damon and Pythias. 1 million members in 1920. Junior Order of United American Mechanics of the United States of North America, 1853. 200,000 members in 1900, opposed to anything non-American, including the Catholic Church. Loyal Order of the Moose, 1888. Still 1.3 million members in 1980. Independent Order of Odd Fellows, 1819. Still 3.4 million members in 1915. Patrons of Husbandry, 1867. Known as the Grange, championed farmers' rights. First to admit women. Improved Order of Red Men, 1847. Claimed origins with the Sons of Liberty. Membership of 520,000 in 1921 in 46 states. Woodmen of the World, 1890. Membership surpassed 750,000 in 1915. Albert Stevens, in his Cyclopedia of Fraternities, posits that, at the beginning of the 20th century, the number of fraternal memberships equaled the number of adult males in the country. This took into account the fact that many men held multiple memberships. In 1831, famed French observer Alexis de Tocqueville wrote in his Democracy in America, "Americans of all ages, all conditions, and all dispositions constantly form associations." Historian Arthur M. Schlesinger Sr. called America a nation of joiners. William Simmons was, therefore, under this definition, a very typical American of the time. He claimed to hold membership, at one time or another, in 12 to 15 fraternal organizations. Alvin Schmidt provides an analysis of this cultural phenomenon in his Encyclopedia of U.S. Fraternal Organizations. These societies can be classified, in almost all cases, in one of two ways: secret orders and benefit societies. Secret orders are all about ritual and secrecy. They are characterized by elaborate ceremonies, ordered rankings, and extensive paraphernalia. Many are restrictive in their membership. Benefit societies are primarily engaged in providing financial security for their members, usually in the form of insurance. While secret orders generally do not exhibit beneficial traits, there are many examples of benefit orders with secret tendencies. There are many reasons for the spectacular growth of fraternal organizations in the late 19th and early 20th centuries. First and foremost, they provided a feeling of importance to the common man. There was a sense of belonging. Most societies did not discriminate economically. Fraternal organizations also helped to socially integrate millions of immigrants to the United States. Between 1860 and 1920, 40 million people left their homelands to come to America. Fraternal orders offered fellowship to these new arrivals. Many, such as the Czechoslovak Society of America, 1854, Polish National Alliance, 1880, Ukrainian National Association, 1894, and Sons of Italy, 1905, were ethnically oriented and often conducted meetings in native languages. The benefit societies provided much-needed economic security. Insurance and death benefits were offered at a fraction of the cost in the general marketplace. Finally, belonging to a fraternal order allowed a certain social prestige for the members during occasions when they could be seen in public with their uniforms, medals, and colorful regalia. This was, generally, a rural movement at the turn of the century. In small towns, it was easy to be noticed for one's fraternal associations. People were more anonymous in major urban areas. The United States was just then tilting toward an urban majority for the first time. After the 1920s, fraternal organization membership began a steady decline. As a rural movement, this was also a primarily Protestant one. The Catholic population was centered in the larger cities. Consequently, there was only one major Catholic order, the Knights of Columbus. William Simmons would belong to many of these organizations, but one would become prominent in his career and in his future aspirations: the Woodmen of the World, founded in 1890 by Joseph Cullen Root in Omaha, Nebraska. Root took the name from a sermon he had heard in church. The pastor spoke about pioneer woodsmen clearing away the forest to provide for their families. Root envisioned a society that would clear away problems of financial security for its members, making it technically a benefit order. The Woodmen of the World provides insurance for its members. Still rising above the Omaha skyline is the 30-story Woodman Tower, constructed in 1969. The order is composed of some 2,000 lodges and more than 750,000 members. Woodmen of the World offers youth programs, camping experiences, disaster relief assistance, and support for the orphaned children of members. Until the 1920s, members were buried under tombstones shaped like tree stumps. This benefit order also happened to have a secretive nature. Photographs from the early 1900s show stern-faced men in military-type uniforms all clutching symbolic axes. One unit has a goat mascot. There are dozens of fancy medals and gold Woodman of the World pocket coins. A look at the new member initiation ceremony from that time tells a great deal about the organization. Everything was written down to the smallest detail. A military component ordered members to present axes, carry axes, return axes. Members entered under crossed axes. There was a carefully ordered series of secret signs, countersigns, and salutes, as well as the ceremonious drinking of pure water. The leaders sat behind stumps on the stage. There was a social song and an opening ode. At one point in the ceremony, the advisor lieutenant says, "Consul Commander, the sovereigns will silently and reverently bow their heads and in self-communion vow to throw aside vexations, cares, and troubles of the outside world and concentrate their thoughts upon the business of the hour, that avarice, selfishness, and hatred may be banished from the forests of woodcraft." Potential new members, their heads covered in what they called a hoodwink, paid their fee and took the Woodman Oath. William Joseph Simmons was intimately versed in all things associated with the Woodman of the World. He rose quickly through the ranks, becoming a colonel at the youngest age then recorded by the order. His command included 5 regiments. The Woodman of the World then hired Simmons for recruiting and insurance sales duties. Within 2 years, he was free of debt and earning between $10,000 and $15,000 a year, a handsome salary in 1913. His new assignment was Atlanta, Georgia. It was at this point in Simmons's life that the first of 3 important events occurred. To begin with, he was injured in an automobile accident and forced to convalesce for a number of months. He took the time to organize his revival of the Ku Klux Klan. Borrowing heavily from the original Klan prescript, Simmons wrote a 54-page pamphlet he named The Cloran. In it, he dreamed up ranks, titles, passwords, and codes, most beginning with the letters KL. Klancraft, similar to woodcraft, was the essence of the Klan. A clavern was a local branch or a meeting place. A clanvocation was a general meeting or convention. The claylif was the vice president and the person who presided over the clanvocation. The kilgrap was the organization's secretary. The kleagles were clan organizers and recruiters. The Cloran was the holy book of the order, and Simmons warned members to keep its secrets away from any person in the outside world. Simmons, however, was also concerned with his financial interest in the organization, and he copyrighted the Cloran on January 6, 1917, duly depositing 2 copies with the Library of Congress. From that day forward, the secrets of the Klan were available in the nation's capital for anyone who wished to view them. Michael Newton describes the new Klan's basic philosophy. "The Simmons Klan would stand for an uncompromising standard of pure Americanism, untrammeled by alien influences and free from the entanglements of foreign alliances." Simmons described clannishness as real fraternity, practically applied, supporting the soul of chivalry and virtue's impenetrable shield. Simmons's knights would shield the sanctity of the home and the chastity of womanhood, while vowing to forever maintain white supremacy. The second event, which would eventually lead to the Thanksgiving Day stand on Stone Mountain, was the sad and sensational case of Leo Frank. On the morning of April 26, 1913, 13-year-old Mary Fagan arose, setting in motion the series of events that would come to reveal a simmering stew of hatred and fear hiding beneath the surface of U.S. society. It was a Saturday, and, more important, Confederate Memorial Day. The Marietta girl planned to attend the festive parade in nearby Atlanta. After eating a breakfast of cabbage and wheat biscuits, Mary dressed herself in her finest clothes, stockings and garters, a store-bought violet dress, gray pumps, ribbons in her hair, and a blue straw hat. She was a very attractive young woman with blue eyes, high cheekbones, a rosy smile, and a busty figure. Steve Oney in And the Dead Shall Rise says of young Mary, "She was exceedingly well-developed for her age. She had undoubtedly already tortured many a boy. There was simply something about her, a tilt to the chin, a dare in the gaze, that projected those flirtatious wiles that Southern girls often employ with devastating effect." She then boarded the English Avenue trolley and headed to downtown Atlanta. The Fagans were not a wealthy family. Originally from Marietta, they had moved to Alabama to farm. Mary's father, William, died there of the measles in 1899, a few months before her birth. Mary's widowed mother, Fanny, moved her family back to Georgia. Fanny eventually remarried, but they barely scratched out an existence in the grimy, industrial tenement suburbs of Atlanta. Like many girls in their situation, Mary had left school to help out at home. Her first job, when she was 10, was in a textile mill. At 11, she worked for a paper manufacturer. In 1911, Mary began work for her present employer, the National Pencil Factory, where she was paid 10 cents an hour to run a knurling machine that inserted rubber erasers into the metal tips of pencils. Child labor had reached a crisis level throughout the United States, and Georgia was the only state that allowed 10-year-olds to work 11 hours a day in mills and factories. Mary Fagan never attended the Confederate Memorial Day parade in Atlanta. On her way to the festivities, she decided to pick up her pay at the National Pencil Factory. At around 3 o'clock Sunday morning, Atlanta police received a call. At 3:30, they discovered Mary's body. She had been savagely raped and murdered. The police first centered their investigation on a black night watchman, but eventually began to suspect the 29-year-old factory superintendent, Leo Frank, who was a Cornell-educated Jew rising rapidly in Jewish Atlanta society. The white Protestant South blamed much of its misfortune on wealthy industrialists. That Frank was Jewish and Northern only served to exacerbate the situation. A black janitor implicated Frank, and he was indicted for the murder. A sensational trial ensued, enlivened by Atlanta newspapers vying for readership. Mobs surrounded the courthouse daily, listening to every word through open windows. The court of public opinion had already convicted Frank. Both the prosecution and the defense presented their cases. The jury deliberated for less than 4 hours. Frank and his defense team were not allowed to be present to hear their decision for fear of mob reaction. The verdict was guilty, and Frank was sentenced to death. A series of appeals ensued, reaching in the end the Supreme Court. An overturn of the decision was denied, and an execution date of June 20, 1915, set. One man came to Leo Frank's defense. Outgoing lame duck Georgia Governor John M. Slayton began to investigate the case, perhaps more carefully than the judge and jury had. Slayton came to the conclusion that some doubt existed in Frank's guilt. On the day before the scheduled execution, Slayton commuted the sentence to life imprisonment and sent Frank to the Georgia prison at Milledgeville. It was an unpopular decision. Slayton and his family left Georgia, and the governor was hanged in effigy by angry mobs. Almost immediately, a group of Marietta men known as the Friends of Mary Fagan began planning an intricate operation. On the afternoon of August 16, 1915, they began the 150-mile journey from Marietta to Milledgeville. At midnight, they turned off their headlights and approached the prison. The passengers covered their faces with crude masks. The men cut telephone wires and handcuffed the warden. It was reported that prison guards, many sympathetic to the cause, offered no resistance to the night invaders. Leo Frank was taken from his cell and placed in an automobile for the 7-hour drive back to Marietta. At dawn, Leo Frank was hanged from a tree 2 miles outside Marietta, Georgia. News of the event spread quickly. Men, women, and children hurried to the grove to look at the dead body of Mary Fagan's accused killer. Photos taken that morning are both bizarre and macabre as the citizens posed with the hanging body. Frank was finally cut down and transported to Atlanta before the mob could burn his body. In Atlanta, people demanded to see Frank's corpse. His remains were then spirited to New York, where he was laid to rest in Queens. As a result of the Leo Frank incident, the B'nai B'rith established the Anti-Defamation League in 1913. In 1982, 69 years after Mary Fagan's death, Leo Frank's office worker, Alonzo Mann, gave information that cast doubt on Frank's guilt. In 1986, the state of Georgia officially pardoned Leo Frank. 3 months after the lynching of Leo Frank, a number of the men who ascended Stone Mountain with William Simmons were former members of the Friends of Mary Fagan. They were among the first recruits to the new Ku Klux Klan. The final circumstance arrived in the form of a cultural milestone from Hollywood, California. Since Griffith, there has been no major improvement in the art of film direction. Frank Capra. People used to flatter me by saying that D.W. Griffith and I were rivals. Griffith had no rivals. He was the teacher of us all. Cecil B. DeMille. He, Griffith, was instrumental in transforming movies from the Nickelodeon novelty to an art form, and he originated and formalized much of the syntax of movie making now taken for granted. Stanley Kubrick. Capra, the director of It's a Wonderful Life and Mr. Smith Goes to Washington, DeMille, the director of film epics such as The Ten Commandments, and Kubrick, the acclaimed director of A Clockwork Orange, were talking about the man who unashamedly titled his autobiography The Man Who Invented Hollywood. David Wark Griffith did not intend to aid William Joseph Simmons in his launch of the modern Ku Klux Klan. He just wanted to be an actor. D.W., as he came to be known, was born on a farm near Crestwood, Kentucky, on January 22, 1875. The Griffith home was a 264-acre plot known as Lofty Green. He was the sixth child of Jacob Wark Griffith and Mary Oglesby Griffith. Born in 1819, the elder Griffith was a virtual history textbook of the middle of the 19th century. At age 21, he apprenticed himself to two doctors. After setting up a medical practice, he soon volunteered as a surgeon in the Mexican-American War, seeing action at Buena Vista and Saltillo. After the war, he married Mary, but was soon on his way to the gold fields of California. Jacob returned, penniless, but soon gained a reputation for oratory and served a term in the Kentucky State Legislature. When the Civil War broke out, Jacob went off to fight for the Confederacy. Kentucky was not a secessionist state, but the Griffiths were slaveholders, and many in Shelby County fought to maintain their economic system. Jacob fought nearly the entire war. He was wounded at least twice and quickly advanced through the ranks to become a cavalry lieutenant colonel. Jacob Griffith returned from the war to a farm in debt. According to Richard Schickel, Jacob Griffith did little with the 20 years of life left to him when the war ended, other than to produce three more children, David in 1875, and drink, and give orations and tell tall tales, and play the fiddle at home and at country dances, and gamble. On March 31, 1885, David's 10th year, Jacob Wark Griffith died at the age of 66. In 1889, the family left the heavily mortgaged farm and moved to the teeming metropolis of Louisville. It was in Louisville that young D.W. was first exposed to the world of theater. At age 16, he began touring as an actor in southern Indiana. In 1897, he left Louisville for the New York stage, for uncertainty, and for the life of a starving artist. Meanwhile, in 1893, Thomas Alva Edison created 15 seconds of history in a black tar paper building in West Orange, New Jersey. Using new, flexible celluloid stock, he filmed his assistant, Fred Ott, sneezing. It was the first motion picture. Soon people were viewing short, simple features in kinetoscope parlors and Nickelodeon galleries. They were intimate, one-to-one viewing experiences. Then Edison created the Vitascope projector in 1896. It was the first movie projector, and now many people could view a film together. The movie theater had been invented. Frank Capra explains this new phenomenon in his foreword to Griffith's autobiography. Film art was to be the first new art created by man since the Greeks had formalized the theater 25 centuries earlier. The story of man previously told with paint and canvas, with sculptured marble, with song and music, with written words in books, with spoken words behind footlights, that same story could now be told in a spectacular new medium. And not in cheap amusement parlors, but in 100,000 movie theaters throughout the world. D.W. Griffith soon realized that his talent was not in front of the camera, but behind it. He went to work for the Biograph Film Company, first as an actor, but primarily as a director. Griffith's first directorial effort was The Adventures of Dolly in 1908. By the time he left Biograph in 1913, D.W. Griffith had directed nearly 450 films. Of those 450 films, Edward Wagenknecht and Anthony Slide estimate 11 were two-reelers and one was a four-reeler. All the rest were one-reelers. A reel, in silent film days, ran approximately 13 to 15 minutes in length. Biograph was focused on the bottom line. Short films meant high output and low budgets. Griffith learned his trade well. He was innovative and groundbreaking. Still, he chafed at Biograph's restrictions. He needed more time to be a better storyteller. He worked very hard at getting Judith of Bethulia, a four-reeler, produced in 1913. It was a critical triumph, but Biograph wanted to return to their time-worn formula. European directors were turning out six-reelers, and Griffith wanted the same freedom. He left Biograph and began looking for a long-form property. He found it in a play from his earlier theater days. In 1906, Griffith had acted as the lead in a production called The Klansman on the New York stage. This openly Southern view of the Reconstruction era by Thomas Dixon had been a best-selling novel before being adapted for the stage. The New York press hated the play, but rural America loved it. The Klansman had the elements Griffith needed for his expansive feature-length film. First and foremost, there was the Civil War. In later life, Griffith would tell a biographer that his first memory was his father's Confederate saber. The elder Griffith would don his old uniform and thrust at imagined enemies for the amusement of his children. D.W. saw great battles to recreate and film. The history of the South was his history. Second, the play has a great rescue scene at the end of the story. Members of the original Klan gallantly ride to save white women from threatening black Union soldiers. Griffith was perfecting an editing technique he called switchback or parallel cross-cutting. The camera would switch back and forth from rescuer to rescued, building tension and anxiety. The story also allowed the director to use his other technical innovations, the close-up, the fade, masks, split screens, vignettes, and the use of an original music score. Dixon wanted $10,000 for the film rights. Griffith didn't have the money, instead offering a percentage of box office receipts. Dixon relented. His choice netted him an eventual million-dollar windfall. Griffith would make a film like no other made at that point. The Birth of a Nation, the title was changed after previews, occupies 12 reels, nearly 190 minutes. The final budget was $100,000, more than double that of any previous movie. There are spectacular battle scenes, immense sets, and a cast of thousands. Most of all, Griffith.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.